All right, tell us your name.
William, comma, Bill Buchan. Buchan, that my dad would say. It's a lot of people around Seattle called it Buchan because there was a bakery called Buchan, and they came from a village not far from my dad's hometown in Scotland. And so for a long time I was Buchan. And does your family own the bakery? No. But all my dad's friends called us Buchan, which is the true pronunciation.
So Scottish background.
Oh yeah, half Scotch, half Norwegian. Yeah.
So how did you get into the sport of sailing?
Well, coming from a background of North Sea fishermen, from the east coast of Scotland, and probably some fishermen from my Norwegian side, from the west coast of Norway, it was kind of in my blood, as my dad would say. And my family moved from Scotland to the U.S. in the early 20s because the fishing industry was really hurting over there. Plus, they were doing a lot of business with the Germans and the Russians. And if you follow the history after the First World War, you know that inflation was 1,000,000,000%. So they'd sell their shipment over to, say, the Germans, and they'd get a nickel back because what they sold it for in marks was worthless, and so they were broke, so they came to this country. And also my grandfather lost a ship in the First World War, so that didn't do him any good. He had a battle with the insurance company, et cetera, et cetera. So anyway, so they came to this country, and then after a few years my dad met my mom, and our first sailboat was a little boat that my dad built on the front porch of our rental house that's still there. And the name was the Wee Will. Wee, of course, meaning small, and Will was my nickname. So the Wee Will was our first boat. It was like a snipe that my dad built, like I said, on the front porch. The transom, Dad wanted to put a nice transom on the boat, and the only piece of bright wood he could find was the top of the dresser in the bedroom in this furnished rental house. So Dad took the top off the presser table that became the transom. We were very frugal, obviously. And then later my dad bought the house, so that eased his conscience. Anyway, that was our first boat.
I just wanted to,
we're
up again, Gary.
Alrighty. So anyway, so you had this small boat that your father helped you sail with. And as growing up, who were some of your mentors, some of your people that you looked up to?
Well, during the war years, the Second World War years, the Corinthian Yacht Club was founded by some wonderful people. Gus Erickson, Hans Autogisa, Charlie Frisbee, I could go on and on, Bob Lamson, they're pretty much all gone now, I would guess. Wonderful people, and they could tell right away that I was had a future in the sport of sailing, and very supportive. And to this day, I just admire the support that I got from that crowd, And then my dad was always building things. He did buy a sailboat during the Second World War from a young man that was going into the service. It was an Ed Monk boat. Ed Monk probably doesn't mean much to you, but he was a pretty famous designer in the Great Northwest, Pacific Northwest. And so then Dad built a series of boats during the later years of the war, 46, 47, 48. And then during 1948, we'd been thinking about buying a Mercury, which was a kit boat. Because Dad would think, well, if we get this boat in kit form, we can just assemble the plywood and whatnot, and we'll make a Mercury. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I guess, the star North Americans was in Seattle in the summer of 48. Guess who was there? Lowell North, Jerry Driscoll, Bill Ficker, and a bunch of other people. And to this day, I look out the window of the dining room of the Seattle Yacht Club, and that's where I saw Lowell. His boat was hanging from the hoist, and typical of Lowell, he was working on the keel. Most people just launch their boat and go sailing, not Lowell. And so I said, Daddy, we're not going to build a Mercury. We're going to build a starboat. So that winter, we built a starboat in our basement, and somehow we got it measured in. And then it took a while before I realized that the competitive starboats were taking advantage of the limitations, the statute of limitations. Even though the statute of limitations said these limitations are only to be used if you make an honest mistake, you're not supposed to take advantage of them. I mean, come on, are you serious? you know, Phil Spaulding's master's thesis at the University of Michigan was starboat design. He was a classmate of Skip Etchell's. And so it took us about three starboats to finally build a boat to the total limit of the statute of limitations. And then we started, you know, doing pretty darn well on a national program. We sailed the North Americans of 54, sailed the North Americans of 53, and my dad was my crew at that time, you know, so anyway, just goes on and on.
Well, it certainly passes down from one generation to the next. Talk a lot about your father helping you, and had your great career, and but you got Carl, and
yeah, that's right. Carl and I were sailing together on a Thistle, and I was his crew. Carl's probably 14, 15 years old, and then we go to Marstrand for the Star Worlds of 70, and guess what? They're sailing over their OK dinghies, and we had a pretty good size OK dinghy fleet in Seattle. So when I came back from the Worlds, I said to Carl, it's time you got your own boat. I'd build him a Penguin and then something else prior to that, but so we found somebody in Seattle had a mold for building up a OK dinghy, so we built an OK dinghy. And away he went on his own. And then, of course, when the Lacer came along, that changed everything.
Well, I think one of the really cool things about your story is that in 1984, both you and Carl, in separate boats, won gold medals in the Olympics.
Yeah, that was cool. That was certainly a big thrill. You know, Carl, he's one of those people. A couple of times, he sails with me a lot, and I used to sail with him quite a bit, but he pulled a tactical maneuver in one of the long distance races up in Seattle. It was a very daring maneuver. I mean, and I thought, and it worked. I thought, I will never question Carl's decision making ever again. You know, he just has that inherent thing, you know, and then his daughter is really into the sport. She married Dalton Bergen, and you know, they sail all the time. And so it's definitely in our family blood. You know, I think my dad was right. It's in our blood, and it's the creativity of doing things with your boat. You know, working on the keel and working on the rudder and trying to get things as perfect. You know, that was just made for my skills. If I just bought a starboard off the shelf someplace, I probably would have quit. Because frankly, I never considered myself to be an excellent sailor, but I consider myself to be really good at crafting a nice piece of equipment, sails, boats, whatever.
So professionally, you built houses or?
Mm-hmm. I'm a home builder.
So you're a home builder, but you're also building stars. Did you have a shop building stars?
Well, I built four or five wood boats for friends, you know, back in the 50s and 60s, I guess, 60s. You know, John Scarborough and some other people that I've known for years. And then when the Star class got into fiberglass, I knew that we couldn't compete with wood anymore. And so I had to get a fiberglass boat. I just wasn't about to buy a boat from the Lippincotts. In fact, I tried to buy a boat for the 68 Olympic trials, because I knew that Lippincott was building a pretty good star boat. You know, Dennis Conner later won the Worlds with one. And so I called up Bob and Lippincott and said, I think maybe I should get one of your boats for the Olympic trials of 68. Prior to the Olympics in Acapulco, and he said, "Nope, we're booked up." You know, so so then I just sailed my wooden boat, and we did fine. We were second to Lowell, as I recall, even though we fouled out of the last race. But then housing took a downturn. Boeing had a huge layoff in the late 60s, early 70s, so you couldn't give a house away, and so I had just. My star career was really starting to take off. And so I thought, well, I'll build star boats. You know, I got a phone call from Lowell. He wanted me to build him a boat. Pete Bennett wanted me to build him a boat. I built boats for local people. And then when we won the Worlds in 70, it really took off. You know, my boat building career really took off. And so when the Worlds were in Seattle in 71, a lot of the boats were my boat, you know.
That's pretty satisfying.
Pretty darn satisfying. And then I didn't realize it until I just looked at one of my old star logs, and that when the Worlds were in Spain in 73, I guess, no, 74, 74, I think it was, 74, 75, Tom Blackaller won. But anyway, I think that five of the top six or seven boats were mine. You know, I thought, what the heck's that all about? I don't remember that, but it was there. You know? So I was a pretty successful star builder. And then once housing came back, then I kind of backed off on the star boat thing. I built a couple of more molds after that, and some friends of mine tried building star boats, but it's not easy. Anyway, I'm rambling a little too much here.
Okay. Stuart's walking into our picture here.
Okay.
Stuart,
how are you?
Fine, thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's right.
You were messing up your sailing. Well, I thought you were pretty bold to say, well, could we move the date?
On a jet ski to make the second race.
Okay. All right. Well,
good to see you again. It's
all right. Hang here. We're rolling along here. We'll be with you in just a few minutes. Okay,
Stuart? Okay. That's right. Okay.
So anyway, what did winning the gold medal mean to you in the Olympics?
Well, it was in the star class, in the U.S. especially, making the team was the tough part. If you got to the Olympics from the U.S., you were probably going to do pretty good in the Olympics. And a couple of people that I would have been really concerned about in the Olympics, so Valentin Mankin from Russia and a couple other people that just didn't qualify, it would have probably had a psychological edge on me. So those threats didn't make the games for some reason, either through the boycott, you know, with Valentin and some other people that were from Eastern European countries. So I went to the Olympics, you know, feeling that it would be, they don't have favorites and whatnot, but I was pretty much a favorite, you know. I hadn't won a Worlds recently, but we were in the top three or four on the Star Worlds for several years prior to the Olympics. And so winning the trials was really a big part, you know, because that was very competitive in those days, and the trials was pretty much the trials. You win the trials or you don't win the trials. And we won the trials and went to the Olympics with being a pretty good favorite, I would guess, and we lived up to our expectations.
But you weren't that young at the time.
Well, looking back, I was pretty young,
yeah, but
I was 49 years old. I remember Hans Vogt was hanging around during the trials. He says, boy, you better win this one, Bill, because you're not going to get another crack at it. And, you know, Hans Vogt is still sailing, whatever he sails, stars, soulings, whatever. But, you know, my son, I would consider to be a favorite if we had an Olympic trials today, or one of the favorites. And you know, he's in his late 50s, mid to late 50s, you know, so I think that we've all, 49 is not as old as it was. When I sailed in the America's Cup on Intrepid with Jerry Driscoll, that 74 America's Cup trials, I was be called grandpa. And I almost was a grandpa. I was a grandpa 4 or 5 years later.
Well, you guys had a pretty good run in 1974 in Intrepid. If I recall, you came one race away.
Well, it was funny, but I don't want to make comments that don't play well, especially to the East Coast crowd, but we won the next to the last race, and we expected the guys in the white hats to come over and congratulate us. The white hat guys never showed up, so we thought, well, they don't really want us to represent the U.S. They're hoping that Courageous can pull it off, so they gave us one more race. It was obvious that the winner of that race would be picked. And me, I was a tactician, I think we broke a backstay or a running backstay or something, and so we did not do well in the last race, and so they picked Courageous, you know. So I think that was the East Coast favorite, and they won the America's Cup, so it all worked out well for them.
Well, the selection committee had served themselves well over a long period of time, selecting the newer boat. So
I think so. We had an uphill battle, And, you know, we were largely a West Coast team, and Jerry once said on the way out to the race, he said, well, we're asking these guys to let us have dinner in their house. So be sure that the fenders aren't out, and be sure that we look upstanding, and we did, of course. But it was a wonderful summer. You know, I learned so much with John Marshall. You know, he was the mainsail trimmer, but he was way more than the mainsail trimmer. You know, he made all the sail calls, and he made some beautiful sails for us. You know, but there, as you well know, there's a lot going on in the background of the America's Cup than just winning races. You know,
really? Did you consider doing any other America's Cup campaigns after that?
Well, there was a campaign a few years later by some group in Texas, and the manager of that group came to my office in Seattle. And I think Tom Blackaller suggested that maybe I would be good to take over the helm of that boat. And even though he came to Seattle, I'd already made up my mind to not accept it, you know. And then I think that the program stayed in the direction they were going. And I think John Coleus was the helmsman or something. He's every bit as good as I am, for gosh sakes. But that's the only time I was ever asked again, you know. And frankly, and even Carl's a little bit this way, we're pretty darn good sailors, but I just really have a hard time telling other people how to run their boats. like when I crewed for Lowell a few years later on his Admiral's Cup boat. And, I think Lowell probably expected a little more out of me, you know. But, you know, I'm trimming the sails and doing this and doing that. But for me to tell Lowell North to tack, are you kidding me?
Well, Bill, I mean, you've been at the high level and sailed against all these superstars, at least of your era. Who amongst them stand out as really special, the great, great sailors?
Well, I really wasn't expecting that question. Lowell North was obviously a big influence because he and I were both the same. We were very good tinkerers, you know, always thinking about a new idea for the mast or something like that. And I can't tell you the number of phone calls that Lowell and I had, say, during the 50s and 60s, you know, so what's your latest thinking on mast shape or, you know, whatnot? And then when he got into the sailmaking business, then we were talking about sails, and, you know, and a lot of my ideas came from Lowell, you know. And he, well, I remember one day Lowell called up and said, you know, I got this great idea for your backstay. Your Boeing aircraft has a surplus store up in Seattle, I understand. And why don't you go ahead and buy what's called a hydraulic cylinder and then connect it up to a hydraulic pump. And then instead of having to go back there and twist the turnbuckle, you can just pump the hydraulic cylinder. And so I did exactly that. And a bunch of people around me said, that doesn't sound legal to me. That sounds like stored energy. You can't do that. Well, I mean, come on, where are we today? Everything is hydraulic. You know, so that was typical of what a conversation that Lowell and I might have had. And then, Buddy Melgus, we didn't sail against each other for a long time, but he was just an amazing sailor. You know, he won the Worlds in San Francisco. He had a huge edge in the sail department. You know, it was pretty obvious that his sails were just so much better, but he was also, you know, a heck of a sailor, had great starts. But I was even more impressed when Buddy won the next year in a mixed bag of conditions, you know, over in Sweden. And he went over there, and I thought, well, if he winning in San Francisco with a flatter sail and this and that, you know, no big deal. But to win in Marstrand in a mixed bag of conditions with what we considered to be kind of a one-condition sail, I was very impressed. He's a very, very impressive. Good sail. You know, then over the years, I've sailed with against Joe Duplin and Skip Etchells, and, you know, it's like I'm playing baseball today, but I batted against Babe Ruth or something, or pitched to Babe Ruth, yeah, or whatever. And so that's such a thrill to have sailed against so many generations of sailors. You know, I got Bob Lippincott stories, and like I said, Skip Etchell stories, and Lil North stories, and Jerry Driscoll stories, and Stuart Walker stories from the Soling days. It's amazing the amount of people I've sailed against over the years, and such a thrill to be competitive against them.
Do you think that your sailing has helped your life in general, your career, your family?
Yeah, it was, you know, like somebody asked my daughter Mara, who you'll probably meet this afternoon, so what was it like raising, you know, being raised in that household? And she says, well, I never saw my dad. He was out in the garage working on his starboats, which is true. You know, I would be out there working till late at night. And during my brief starboat building career, I forgot to mention that I built a mold, and then the Clark Boat Company took over the mold, or they built the mold from my plug, you might say, and then they did all the glass work. So my work was, I had a keel made by a local foundry, and I put them together in my garage. And I remember once I worked all night long because somebody from New Orleans, Buzzy Killeen's wife, was going to come and pick up the boat. So I worked through the night to get the boat done so that when she showed up in the morning, it would be there for her, you know. So that was
good. Bill, how did you feel when you get the phone call that you're going to get inducted here to the National Sailing Hall of Fame with so many others? Tom Blackholer, one of your friends.
Yeah, that's for sure. What a friend.
How'd you feel about it?
It was a thrill. I had, what was interesting was I had just just turned my phone on the airplane landing at the Boeing field or SeaTac in Seattle. And I was a little bit down because I hadn't done as well in the world as I thought I would do. So I'm sitting there kind of semi-morose, and this phone call comes in. I think, what? I couldn't even finish in the top half of the fleet, you know, in the Star Worlds. And I actually went into the regatta thinking I would be a semi-threat, you know, not a real threat, but I thought maybe I could finish in the top 15 or 20, and then I lowered my sights to maybe finishing the top half, and we didn't even do that. But it was a thrill for sure. And a surprise, and as I look back, why did they pick me? You know, what have I done? But all my friends say that you deserve it, so I guess maybe I do deserve it, I don't know.
You do, no doubt about it.
I guess.
All yeah. Right, well, thank you very much.
Well, thank you for such neat questions.
We'll see you over there.
Okay, good.